.NET Core development with Visual Studio for Mac? You bet. Join me and Sayed Hashimi to find out about all the cool new features on Visual Studio for Mac on .NET. On .NET today, I'm joined by Sayed Hashimi, a PM for Visual Studio for Mac, to talk about .NET development on your Mac OS.
Yeah, right. It's great to be here, Christos. Yeah, thanks too, a lot, man, for inviting me out here, buddy. So yes, I wanted to spend some time talking about Visual Studio for Mac, and you know, I want to focus more on .NET Core and ASP.NET Core. Before we do that, you know, I wanted to give like a quick 1 or 2 minute rundown of the various different types of apps that you can build with Visual Studio for Mac.
Yes.
So first off, let's start out with the mobile category here. So we've got Xamarin Forms. There's two flavors for mobile here. Mm-hmm. You've got Xamarin Forms, and with Xamarin Forms, you'll develop your the application, the model, the services, and the UI, and then that's shared across the different platforms. So let's say iOS and Android, and then we've got the native projects for iOS and Android, mm-hmm. and in that case, you'll develop your models and services and share those across. But for the actual UI, you would create a native specific UI for each target framework that you're using there.
All using .NET,
yeah, exactly.
Brilliant.
That's right. And then for the web and cloud, we've got full support for .NET Core and ASP.NET Core. You can create a variety of different types of applications there. You can create console apps or different types of web apps, whether mm-hmm. they're just regular ASP.NET Core website or web APIs or SPA types of apps.
Okay.
And then we'll demo some of those as well.
Brilliant.
And then obviously with the Azure Functions, you can create your serverless types of applications there. And we're currently working on the Blazor support in Visual Studio for Mac, so that'll be coming soon. But some of that functionality already works, but some of it doesn't work. So
yeah, so you can run Blazor-based mm-hmm. projects, you just can't create them. The templates are not there yet.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Yeah, and there's a little bit more to it, but essentially, you can open, build, run, and debug Blazor server-side applications.
So almost there.
Almost there, almost. Yeah. Now we're waiting for editor support, and also there's some publishing support that needs to happen.
Okay.
The team is hard at work on that, mm-hmm. So we'll get there soon, I'm sure. So why don't we go ahead and switch over? Oh, and the third component, or the third different type of app that you can create with Visual Studio for Mac is gaming and 3D real-time with Unity. So those are some different types of apps that you can create for the gaming or 3D side as well.
Right.
We're not going to be going into that in this particular talk, because we're going to be more focused on .NET Core and ASP.NET Core.
Right.
So let me show you. Let's first get started with like a typical ASP.NET Core website, or the type of app that, if you've been developing with ASP.NET Core in the past, you might be used to.
Okay.
So to demonstrate that, we've got, it's a kind of a sample reference application. It's called eShop on Web, and that's actually one aspect of like a different larger sample that's called eShop on Containers.
Right.
But we'll take a look at eShop on Web today. So this is hosted in GitHub here. So what we'll do is we'll go ahead and first clone this to my local machine.
Right.
And then we'll go ahead and get it running in Visual Studio for Mac and go from there.
Awesome.
So in GitHub, I'm just going to copy the clone URL. In my case, I'm using SSH as the authentication mechanism, but you can always use HTTPS as well. So I'll just go to version control and select checkout here. Okay, I'm going to paste in my URL. And then, you want to examine this target directory, make sure that's the place that you want it to go to. I'm fine with that. So I'll go ahead and click checkout here. So now this is using Git to go ahead and clone the remote repository to my machine.
And the nice thing about that is integrating the tool, right? So Visual Studio for Mac gives you the interface that you want to interact with. Rather than doing it from the command line, you do it from the UI.
That's right. Yeah, exactly. With Git, there's different types of approaches there. Some people prefer the built-in IDE tooling, and mm-hmm. other people prefer the command mm-hmm. line. But whichever one of those preferences that you have, the IDE is there to support you, whether you support one or the other.
Excellent.
Yep. So we're going to let this, so now you saw after we did the checkout, it discovered the solution file and automatically loaded that in Visual Studio for Mac.
Yeah.
And now we're ready to party on this application.
And even restore the packages for the solution.
Yeah,
so
that's
more
right.
More or less, you're good to go.
So now we're good to go. Now what I want to do is, I want to take a look at the settings for this application to make sure that they're oriented to work on Mac as well.
Sure.
So that's the first thing you want to do whenever you open up like an open source type of project. And for settings, there's two places you want to look at. One is appsettings.json, which I've loaded up here. And the other one is launchsettings.json. So for launch settings, the first thing I'll do is I want to switch this over to development. Okay, that's going to enable better error messages as well as enabling running any sort of EF migration that might need to be there.
Which is building into the framework, which I love as well for .NET Core.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And then if I take a look at these connection strings for appsettings.json, I can see that these are local DB style connection strings. So I'm going to go ahead and change that to something that works cross-platform.
Yeah, because one of the things that we lack on macOS is support for SQL. Although there is support for running SQL on containers, so that would be another option if you wanted to use the localized version of SQL, just for people to be aware.
That's right. That's right. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm just saying data source equals app.db. So what that is SQLite.
Right.
So basically, if the app.db file doesn't exist, when you try to run the application in development mode, it'll detect that that database is missing. Okay. It'll create it, and then all your migrations will be run. So that's the idea here. But yeah, that does require switching over to development mode and launchsettings.json, which I've already done. And yeah, let's go ahead and run this. I will start without debugging.
See it in action.
Well, that's really great. We got our eShop on web running here, dude. All we had to do is clone it, make a couple tweaks to the settings.
And we're off to go in the market and make some money, right?
And then we're good to go. You know, I could take this app here and just kind of replace the products and have my own little shopping cart going here, you know? So yeah, we see it's a fully functioning app here. Let me add a couple things to the shopping cart. I can update that. I can check out. So on and so forth. So this is just like your typical vanilla ASP.NET Core website, you know, and everything's happening on the server side. I'm not even sure if there's even a single JavaScript file in this project here.
Must be some CSS and some JavaScript.
Yeah, there is some kind of CSS, but there's not a whole lot of JavaScript happening with eShop on web. Most of it's handled on the server side.
Yep.
But yes.
The whole point of that repository is to show what ASP.NET Core can do for you, right?
Yeah, so that's right.
It's great to see that you can clone it and straight away start working. So if your team works across Visual Studio on Windows and Visual Studio for Mac, then there's no issue there. They're interchangeably working.
Yeah.
Sans the differences there on the database, but
oh, again, sure,
this
right.
is something you can work around.
Yeah, that's right. And you know, with the extensibility that we have for app settings, you can modify your startup.cs to where it could pick up a file that's not actually checked into source control. So if you wanted it set up to where on the Mac machine you use SQLite and on the Windows machine you use LocalDB, that's totally easy to do. It's very easy to go ahead and set that up. Working the way that we approach these projects is, you know, we want people who are in teams to be able to use whatever tool that they want to use. You know, there's some people who have a preference with Windows and Visual Studio Windows. Others prefer, let's say, Visual Studio for Mac, running on their Mac, and even for other people, they got Visual Studio Code.
Yep.
Whichever one of those tools that particular developer or team likes to use, they should all be able to work together here. So that's why, you know, we're sharing a lot of different components from Visual Studio and the different IDEs and also Visual Studio Code. So so at the end of the day, you know, we want to bring the development experience to where the developer is the most comfortable and where they find their home is at, basically.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
And I have both a Mac and a Windows machine, so I like to jump from one project to another and, you know, one machine to another without really having to think about, oh, is this going to work or is this going to be missing features. And I know that we've done a lot of work over the past few months to make the Visual Studio for Mac editing experience much better. I think we're going to jump into that later, right?
That's right. Yeah, we have done a lot of work for editing and all across the board and bringing over more and more components. Like one thing that I just showed you here kind of briefly was, you know, I went into launchsettings.json and flipped it from production to development mode.
Yep.
That's something that's a relatively new feature to Visual Studio for Mac. One thing that was here that I didn't actually talk about here was the browser dropdown. So When you want to run your application, you can pick the browser that you want to show. And this is the exact same list that shows up in Mac system preferences for picking default browser.
Okay.
There are a couple items here that don't necessarily look to me like browsers, like iTerm and Snagit, but that's the exact same list that shows up for default system browser in Mac OS. So that's how we represent it here as well. So now let me show you a different type of application that you can load up here. We just looked at the kind of vanilla web app.
Yep.
Let's take a look at something that's a little bit more front-end heavy. So this is a Tailwind Trader's website. I think there's a set of tutorials associated with this as well, or a set of samples, I mean. And this is the website aspect of it. There's also a mobile app for iOS and Android. We're not going to get into that part of it, obviously. But this is actually a React application that's kind of created with the ASP.NET Core. So let me go ahead and open that application, and then we'll get that one running.
Yep. And the nice thing about Tailwind Traders is that it's always up to date. We have it as one of our flagship sample apps. So when people want to test their IDs, they want to test how or see how code works or architecture, then this is a great place to go and clone that project and see how it's been put together.
Mm-hmm.
Yep,
that's right. So yeah, now I've got my Tailwind Traders app loaded up here, and we can see we've got the app.js file here, and you know this is just kind of you know your typical ASP.NET Core plus React type of application here. Let me go ahead and run this then. So I'll start without debugging again.
So this project has slightly more dependencies to set up. And I think as part of the setting up, you have to also have, for example, NPM and Node to ensure that you download and package the SPA component of the app properly. So it's a little bit more involved in setting it up. But once you have it up and running, then it's more or less the same experience that you have on Windows as well.
That's right, yeah. So while that's kind of getting loaded up, let me go and kind of point out a few things here, basically. So after I cloned this to my local machine, what I did was, on a terminal, I went into the client app folder, and we can see here, I went in, maybe we can't actually see it here. Let me do show all files, I guess. There should be a package.json file. Yes, it's right there. It just wasn't included in the project itself. So on the command line, I went into client app, and then I ran npm install. And there was a couple kind of warnings there that I needed to address as well. So I went ahead and took care of those warnings. And then I believe that was it. Let me switch back to not showing all files. But once again, you know, you obviously always want to check your app settings.
Yep.
So in this case, this one looks fine. And then let's take a look at launch settings.json as well. This one, I believe it was already configured as development, but if not, you want to go ahead and switch that over to development, I think. And let me switch back to the browser. All right, so here we can see we've got the Tailwind Traders application loaded up and running here. And I kind of mentioned the mobile apps, so you can easily acquire those. You can log in as well, or you can take a look at look through various different products by category.
And, yep.
You know, so that's just, you know, a different type of app that you can create with Visual Studio for Mac.
And .NET Core.
Yeah, and .NET Core, of course, obviously. All right, so what I was thinking about now was maybe this would be a good chance to show everybody how they can enable C# 8 and then some of the kind of special features we have for C# 8 and Visual Studio for Mac.
And we already have support for .NET Core 3.0, by the way. It's still in preview, but we already support it.
Yeah,
and
that's right.
C# 8.
That's right, yeah. So from 8.2 forward, we support .NET Core 3 preview. And the only thing you have to do there is, you know, you'll install Visual Studio for Mac, and then if you want to try out .NET Core 3, go and download the preview SDK and install it, and your IDE will basically light up with that functionality.
Fantastic. Yeah.
So I'll show everybody that too. So let me go to my IDE. I'm going to open a solution that I've been working on, and it's a solution that consists of three projects. It's essentially a .NET Core console project, but more specifically, it's a .NET Core global tool.
Mm-hmm.
And so I've already actually been developing this with C# 8. So it's already configured, but let me show you how you would go and enable that if you hadn't already. So you'll right-click on your project and choose Options. Go down into the General tab under Build, and then here's where you would pick your language version here.
Right.
And then after you install .NET Core 3, you should see version 8 to appear in this list.
Mm-hmm.
You click OK, and then you're off to the races there. So the three projects I have here are the kind of the console project itself, shared .NET standard library project, and then a unit test project. And I've already configured all those to work with C# 8, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, what, you know, there's one thing to have a IDE or an editor that will enable you to kind of type out C# 8 code, right?
You
know, that's one thing, obviously. You know, that's really great. But there's a little bit more to it when you're using, let's say, Visual Studio for Mac or Visual Studio on Windows. You know, it's like, let's say if you type in the normal code that you're always used to typing in.
Yep.
The cool part is, you know, now we've got these Roslyn analyzers which are aware mm-hmm. what language version you're targeting. And then if you're targeting version 8, then they could actually light up, you know, specific analyzers and quick fixes
right.
to help you kind of improve your code and make it kind of more streamlined and more readable. So here I have an example of that. So this is some code that, you know, I probably would have written a year ago, and this is what I was used to before, you know, and then I typed it into the IDE, and then I noticed I get these little kind of green underlines under my code, right? So that's an indication that, hey, there's one or more quick fixes mm-hmm. available here that you might want to try to take a look at. So let's go take a look at this. And we notice that I'm going from line 19 to 28 here, basically, right?
Yeah.
So now let's do these... let's do these quick fixes. So it says, using simple, change to use simple using statement.
Okay.
All right, so this is something new that's came in with C# 8. So you can see it.
Check this out.
It removed the parentheses, removed the block, and then I've got an additional one here as well. Let's go ahead and go into that. Boom. So now it's changed from 19 to 28 to about 26, but removing those braces, you know, at least to me, it makes it a lot easier to read. You know, you don't have to figure out when is this coming in scope and when is this going out of scope. And then in this case, you know, it really kind of highlights where you can have an IDE that actually could, you know, help educate you and actually
yes.
help teach you new things. You know, and kind of, you know, fixing up your code as you go along with it. You know what I mean?
Correct.
So I think it's really great. And let me show you another kind of quick fix. Here it is. So I'll show you another quick fix. This is not specific to C# 8, but more, I think, C# 7. But still very cool. You know, I've got this string format here.
Yep.
And with C# 7, we have the interpolated strings. So I can say convert to interpolated string. And we can see in this case, it's going all the way off to this side. So let's see what happens when I do that. So then it just kind of fits in there. You know, that's much easier to read, easier to maintain. And, you know, it's just one less thing to kind of think about. So
you can use the IDE to modernize your code and learn as you go, mm-hmm. and then improve the readability of your code, more or less, and make it more concise.
Yeah, right, exactly, right.
That's the whole benefit of having an IDE to support you in your development. And it's nice to see where things are going, especially with the latest features around C# 8.
Yeah, right. That's
I think next step is for everybody to go out there and download Visual Studio for Mac if they don't have it already.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Sayed, thanks very much for coming today. It was great to find out about all the cool new features that we have on Visual Studio for Mac. And thanks, everyone, for tuning in. If you want to get started with Visual Studio for Mac, make sure you visit aka.ms/VS4Mac-download. Thank you.